Germanness and Jewishness, he argued explicitly that German Jews should fully commit themselves to Germany, and that German and Jewish ideals are nearly identical, or at least complementary when not identical. Interestingly enough, in the years directly prior to his death, he saw Germany close its doors to Eastern European Jews who were stateless. Again, the precedent that Arendt is also working with in her book on totalitarianism. He saw stateless Eastern European Jews knocking at the door of Germany, and Germany deciding that it would not let them in. And of course, one of the explicit reasons was that German unemployment was already so difficult. But we also saw during that time increased public increased and virulent public discourse on anti-Semitism. And so Cohen took a public position then, and insisted that Germany open its doors. And even in the face of German repulsion of the Jews, Cohen continued to believe in the ideal complementarity of Germanness and Jewishness. Now, it seems like, well, given that Cohen was in some sense arguing against political Zionism, the idea that there ought to be a state for the Jews, and that it would be exclusively for Jews, or at least predominantly for Jews, and it would be a safe haven, and it would be based on Jewish religious affiliation, one could say, well, Cohen clearly didn't realistically enough assess how extraordinarily catastrophic Germany would become for the Jews, so Zionism wins the day. But actually, it's interesting that Cohen's tragic embrace of Germany as fatherland did not lead to a rush to Zionism as opposed to German affiliation. And in fact, Arendt is a very interesting figure here, since she clearly read Cohen and she knew the debates, complex debates, between Cohen, Sholem, and others. Benjamin also was following that. Benjamin read Cohen, cited him in his critique of violence, very importantly, had quarrels with Cohen, but everybody engaged Cohen, including Arendt. But what Arendt seemed to conclude from this standoff, well, either we embrace Germany, stay German Jews, or we embrace political Zionism, was that that neither could really work any longer, and indeed the notion of the nation itself had to come into a fundamental crisis. Now, I hope to be able to talk about that a little bit, how the nation comes into a fundamental crisis. But first, let me just note this about Arendt and Europe. Arendt also continued to share this kind of belief in Europe as a set of ideals, a kind of queer Eurocentrism. And in this context, it's interesting to note that in the early 40s, when Arendt was contributing to war journalism in Germany and in France, she argued in favor of this Jewish army. And I raise this because it's really peculiar. I mean, how would a Jewish army get organized? She wanted the Jewish army to be in Europe, you know, like in Saas-Fee. And she wanted it to be against Hitler, against Nazism. She also saw that it might have to be against Italian fascism as well. And she imagined that it would work in concert with other European armies. So at that point, in the early 40s, she was imagining the Jews as a nation among nations, but they're a European nation. Okay. So there would be Italians, there would be French, there would be the British, there would be the Jews, and everybody would be a nation. And there would be a kind of federated, you know, a kind of precursor to the European community, a federated organization of armies, and there would be different battalions representing different nations. So at that point, she was willing to see the Jews as a kind of nation. But they, oddly enough, were a nation that belonged as part of Europe. Okay. She wasn't able to sustain that, but it was an interesting moment, and it was, in some ways, a way of correcting Hermann Cohen, claiming, no, the Jews are not going to marry Germany, that's not going to work, but they might be their own kind of separate nation, but a nation in Europe. Yeah.
So in that framework, how did she account for Jews who were not from European?
That's the big question. That's the big question. And it was really clear that one of the things she was trying to do was to make Jews European, or to only regard significant Jews as European, or to restrict her understanding of who the Jewish people were to a European one. Let me get there in a moment if I can. But did you want to?
I just wanted to clarify because.
But you guys didn't give me your names, and I.
Oh. Parajaya Ahada. Did you want to?
Do I call you Kara?
Sure, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Patricia.
I'm
just curious, is it related to, I'm just trying to like situate how it would function in her mind's eye. Would it all be parallel to what, say, happened not that long ago, maybe 8 years ago in Roma? Gypsies were arguing for nation status as a legislative body but without a territory.
Yes.
Is that similar?
Yes. Yes. Okay. It is very similar. Because, of course, she's thinking about Jews as diasporic, as wandering, right, and not as having a homeland to which they would return, but as belonging to all the various European nations where they're found. She's still clearly identified and affiliated with Germany, but she wants there to be a separateness to that nation. So it would be a gathering of the nation of Jews in Europe and as European, rather than in the Middle East and as Zionism of that sort. It wouldn't be, and in fact, she didn't want a nation. She didn't want a polity. She didn't want a state. She wanted an army. And that's also interesting, right? You've got a nation without a state, and you've got an army without a state. So she's obviously trying to work out some...
Jesuits.
Jesuits. She's working out some pretty intense, ambivalences here. And indeed, I think what she finally ends up doing by the time she writes on the origins of totalitarianism in 1961 is really finally to say, you know what, the nation doesn't work. Okay, so let's imagine the Jewish army as a kind of early position where she's still trying to hold on to some notion of the nation, and then she ends up saying it doesn't work. And indeed, even the Jewish army is a kind of odd federation. If it's part of a European set of armies, it's a kind of federation of nations. And I would just want to point out that the idea of a federation is extremely important to her thinking. In the early part of her thinking, she imagines a federation of nations. In the later part of her thinking, she imagines a federation that would undo nationalism. Okay, and that. Try to get there in a moment. Yes, please.
Henry?
Yes.
Philosopher, and then you then. What did she think, or you think, about territories of thoughts?
Territories of thoughts. You mean, should thought itself be territorial? You see, I think not. I mean, I don't think that she would ground thinking in territory. I think Cohen maybe did by trying to actually call something Germany or call something German. But the idea of